Good evening, everyone. Glad to have you here this evening, and happy almost Sabbath to each of you. Glad to have you here this evening as we share a few things about Seventh-day Adventist Christian education. It is my privilege tonight to just spend a few minutes telling you what's going on in the Carolina Conference with our schools. This is my 41st year working in Adventist education, beginning my sixth year in the conference office as Superintendent of Education for Carolina, and it has been a joy to serve the schools throughout the Carolinas. I'd like to ask if they would please bring up the PowerPoint presentation. I have a few slides to share with you this evening, and you can, once that's pulled up, you can also go to the first slide that has a quotation from Ellen White. Ellen White, of course, the source of much of what we do in our schools. She had a lot to say, she and her husband, about how our schools should be founded and where we should be heading with our schools. The basis of her quote from the Book of Education, page 13, that we're probably all quite familiar with. She says that our schools should be the harmonious development of the physical, the mental, and the spiritual powers. I know that in all of our schools, our teachers are always trying to focus on these three areas. What a joy it is to see our kids involved in service, to see our kids involved in physical education, and of course, the spiritual powers that Jesus Christ has to bring them. I'd like to bring up the next slide. I just love this quotation. I'd like you to dwell on it for just a second as I read it. Ellen White tells us in counsels to parents, teachers, and students that it is our responsibility to guard the avenues of our kids' soul, to guard their senses and guard what our children see, hear, taste, touch, and smell. You know, I have three children of my own. I can't imagine what it would be like if I just sent them out into the world and expected them to be able to discern what things are good to see and smell and hear and allow them to just do that on their own. What a privilege it is for us as parents to be the first educators of our children in the home. And then it's our responsibility in our schools to follow our parents' guidelines with our kids, to guard those sentences. If that slide could come back up again, Paul in the New Testament also talks about the same thing. He says in Philippians chapter 4 and verse 8, whatsoever is pure, true, just, and lovely. Let's think on those things. As teachers, are we focusing our kids on those things that are pure and true and lovely? It's a huge responsibility in our classrooms. You know, here in the Carolinas, along with the rest of our schools in the North American Division, it was only a few years ago that we were saying that over the past 15 years, over 20% of our Seventh-day Adventist schools in North America had closed their doors. It was also happening here in Carolina. Over the last several years, we've had a few schools close their doors. But we've also had an explosion these last few years of education, especially in our elementary schools where we're seeing our churches support our schools and we're seeing more and more kids coming out of public school or other religious school systems. It really doesn't take much as a parent to look on the news or to see what's taking place in these schools to know that the things that we just talked about, guarding our kids' senses, making sure the things that they see and hear are lovely and pure are just not taking place out in the world today. And it's our responsibility to bring them back to that original plan that God had to keep our kids safe from the world and what it has to bring. The next slide I have, just again for your thinking, parents especially and grandparents, what is it that our kids learn from us, whether it's in the home or in the school? Did you know that our kids learn four major things from us? First of all, our kids learn how to communicate with other people. It's the way we communicate in our home with each other as spouses, that our kids learn how to communicate with the world around them. How to raise children, it's the way we raise our kids in our home, that our children are taught how to raise their children. It's also the place in our home where we teach our children how to treat our spouse. How is it, husband and wife, that you're treating the other individual? Our kids are watching us each and every day. In fact, they are learning each and every moment as we treat each other in the home. We're teaching them how to do that. And then the last on that slide is how to be a Christian. If we're not teaching our kids in our home and in our schools how to treat other people, how to be a true Christian, how to follow Jesus, how to keep that path open with him all the time, we're not doing our job that God has established for us. The next slide I'd like to show you is really eye-opening. You can't read it, and so I'll summarize it for you. It's very small print. You probably have heard of Bailey Gillespie's study, Value Genesis study. It's really been going on for about 30 years, and the biggest part of the study was about 20 years ago. But I get somewhat monthly updates from that survey because they keep surveying people and we get information. That survey that was just up there shares that the very number one way that our kids develop their faith development with Jesus is in our Seventh-day Adventist schools. And then it goes down from there in our homes, in our Pathfinder groups. It's all of these groups that we involve our kids with that are related to the church and keeping our kids connected in their faith to Jesus through our denominational entities. We need to make sure that in our local churches, those things are strong for our kids, that we're encouraging our kids to participate. The next slide also just briefly want to tell you that in the home as well, there are four things that, you know, the number one thing that's important in your home to develop in your child is to develop faith maturity, because they're going to go out into the world, and it's that faith maturity that they develop that will determine whether they remain faithful in the church or strong in the church or not. And the four things that we could do is, number one, as parents, we need to show moral standards in our homes. Secondly, we need to be talking to our children about faith. When I first read this in the study from Gillespie, I started looking in my own home thinking, how often do I talk to my own children about what Jesus has done for me? Did you know that that's a huge factor in developing faith maturity in your child, being willing and able to continually talk? The third thing there is providing service projects for your kids. We all know, and in our schools and in our churches, we provide service projects. That is so key. Serving others teaches our kids how to serve others in their community. It's those kind of activities that will develop the faith in your kids. And then, of course, family worship. You cannot have a substitute for having Jesus in the home, having our kids see that Jesus is important to us as parents, and that we worship in the home. We teach them how to worship, and even more importantly, that we allow our children to be the leaders of worship in our home. There was nothing more fun than our worship times at home when we would tell our three kids, all right, you're in charge of worship tonight. Go in the back room, come out, teach us the lesson. And I'll tell you, the kids had a lot of fun doing that. That's all part of growing their faith maturity. We know that our school started many years ago, and Goodloe Harper Bell, who was recuperating in the sanitarium, started teaching some of the boys he came in contact with. Ultimately, he moved his school in the sanitarium over to the local Review and Herald office, and then our first school in Battle Creek, that was open. That's been a long heritage of what Seventh-day Adventist education is. And if we could look at the next slide, we know that Ellen White and James White, without their pushing in those first few decades, we would not have the system we have today. Ellen White said that we need schools for those who are just entering the ministry to be taught at least common practices of education, where they can also learn more perfectly from the truth words of God. And then James White said the church needs to prepare young men and women to become printers, editors, and teachers. I don't know how many printers we need today, but I sure do know we need teachers. Some of you probably have seen in your bulletin, for the last couple of months, we've been running ads in your church bulletins that we are looking for teachers. With the explosion of students and the growth of our schools in this conference, we have been adding teachers all over the place. If you know of a teacher that would like to get back into Seventh-day Adventist education or is acquainted with it, we would love to talk to them. We need teachers in our schools. And across this country, there are schools in danger of closing because we cannot find enough teachers. That's a wonderful problem to have. But we know that those are also a result, again, of our parents and our kids saying, what's been out in the world, we cannot continue to condone. We want to have them in a place where they can be led by God. The next slide that I have shares the growth of schools in the Carolinas. You can see back in 1880, there were only two Seventh-day Adventist schools. Today, we have over 8,000 schools across this world. And in the Carolinas here, we operate 20 schools in North and South Carolina. And the enrollment over the past 5 years has increased in our schools from 535 to well over 880 this year. An incredible explosion of education in the Carolinas. I want to thank you as members in our churches, as supporters of Seventh-day Adventist Christian education, for making our schools strong. I'd like to introduce to you this evening Kara Simons. Kara has been one of our teachers for several years here in the Carolinas, taught over here a few years ago in Westminster, and then most recently up at our school at Tri-City. And now just recently, she has accepted the call to come to the conference office and is serving as the Associate Superintendent of Education for the Carolina Conference. I want you to know that Kara is dedicated to our kids. If you ever saw her at work in the classrooms, you would know and you would trust, just like our other teachers, that they are preparing our kids each and every day to be led and to have faith maturity, as we've spoken of here today. Kara, thank you for being here tonight. We look forward to many more years of having your leadership in the Carolinas.
Thank you, Rick, for introducing me. I actually got my start in the Carolina Conference when I was 4 years old. I started going to Carolina Conference schools and went through Carolina Conference schools all the way up through 12th grade, which were able to set me up for success and were able to lead me here to this position. I also continued Adventist education throughout my college career, both undergrad and graduate. We have an absolutely amazing group of teachers in our conference here. I see several of them are out here in the audience tonight, and if you're here at the program tomorrow night, you're gonna get to see many more of them because we're having a prayer of dedication for all of our teachers with Elder Louis tomorrow evening. As I said, we have a wonderful group of teachers. I've enjoyed working with them as a fellow teacher over the last several years, and I'm looking forward to continue to getting to work with them as the associate superintendent. One of our schools that we have the blessing of being able to have is Mount Pisgah Academy. I don't know if any of you have had the chance to be able to drive over there this week or have ever gotten the opportunity to see it, but we want to tell you a little bit more about that. We have a representative from Pisgah here tonight. I would like to introduce you to Kevin Wirth.
Good evening, my name is Kevin Wirth, as Kara said, and I'm a vice principal of finance. And really quickly, if there's anyone, I work with a lot of families to help them afford Mount Pisgah Academy. If there's anyone you know that is considering or thinking that they can't afford it, would you please find me, let me know somehow, because we want to do whatever, we can do a lot to make it happen. So I just want to let that be known. Please let me know if any students need financial help. Really quickly, just gonna say a couple things about mission. Mount Pisgah Academy is known for mission service. 20 years ago, we had our first school-wide mission trips where every student had to choose a mission trip to go on. And Rick Anderson was our principal at that time. And thank you, Mr. Anderson. And usually when we do that every 4 years, there's usually 6 or 7 trips, and it's a mixture of international and domestic trips. And last year we did that, and I was involved with a local Asheville group, but we had a group go to Alaska. I knew I was going to forget Honduras, Dominican Republic. Anyway, there was several. And the other thing I wanted to mention really quick is we also were the first academy to do Share Him. And that is probably, in my opinion, the biggest thing we do. I think the most important thing we do. Of course, as Seventh-day Adventists, we value very highly the opportunity we have to spread the gospel. And in 2010, or about that time, we went on our first Share Him trip, working with Jeremiah Weeks and his staff. And what a blessing it is. We're going to see a video shortly about this year's trip to the Dominican Republic with our students. Many baptisms take place every year after those meetings, and oftentimes, it's the student preachers themselves. They come back, they've been so convicted by all the sermons they preached, they want to be rebaptized or baptized. And we've even had non-Adventist students that went to be the preacher, came back and wanted to be baptized in the Adventist church. So it's just an amazing ministry, and we're so fortunate to be able to do that. And of course, we have staff to go with them too. But before the video, I would like to introduce two seniors that are gonna sing a duet. Rachel Hampton. Both of these girls graduated high honors a couple weeks ago. Rachel Hampton is the redhead, and Leah Ashlock, you may know these girls, but Leah Ashlock is the one in the brown hair, and they're going to sing the prayer.
Yeah. This year for mission trips, we went to the Dominican Republic.
While I was in Barahona, me and the other missionaries were able to spread God's word, and we were able to preach to many different churches in the area.
We went there to preach, but not only to preach, we were able to visit other places, and we were able to meet people and eat different kinds of foods.
We did a lot of activities such as visiting rivers and lakes. We gave out food to homeless people. We practiced for our sermons during the day.
We met many different people, and we really made family with all the churches that we visited.
On the mission trip, we preached 11 sermons, and every night we would go and preach a sermon to our church because we had our individual church.
We had these baptisms at the beach, and being there, I met so many people and made so many friends. Even though it was hard to communicate, we were able to use hand gestures and get other people to translate for us, and it was a blessing to be able to still connect with them and be able to still sing with them and hug the people after they got baptized.
My biggest miracle was definitely my first night in Dominican Republic, because there was a night where we were told who our speakers and the church that we'd get. And I got this one lady, she was very sweet. She was around my age actually. However, she could speak English, but she didn't know very much from the Bible in English per se. And so the very first night that I got her, we got halfway through our sermon and it was like 80 slides long. And so that was frustrating because we both really wanted to get through this, but we couldn't. And then I was stressed and she was stressed and I wasn't able to communicate with my church at first. But then, like the next day, she told me she couldn't be my speaker anymore and she just left. And I freaked out. And then everyone in the hotel freaked out. And I think I talked to someone, I think it was Pastor Freddie, and he said that he found someone and that I would meet them the day of my sermons. I saw this guy walk into the church and I didn't know who exactly they were, but I asked them if they were like the conference pastor, and he was like, no, but I'll be your speaker. From there, it just clicked and I got to keep him for the whole week as my translator, and so that was a big blessing.
Something I really like about mission trips is that I'm able to really connect with other types of culture and different types of people, and I'm also able to really like speak another language with them. And honestly, meeting people in other countries is just a totally different experience.
Because seeing the people of the church still happy, even though they had a small church and even though like they didn't have much, they were still so happy and they always showed up every night, no matter the circumstance.
While I was there and I was up preaching to my church people, not only was I preaching to them, but it was also preaching to myself, not just to the people, but also for me to learn something.
I thought it was one of my best experiences here at Mount Pisgah Academy, being able to connect with new people, being able to even get closer to my friends here. It was all just an overwhelming, great experience, and I would definitely go back.
God can take a person like myself and turn them into preachers.
I'm not necessarily the type that likes to speak in front of people. And so being taken out of my comfort zone has definitely, like, it's been easier to be able to talk out in public, especially when I'm talking about Jesus.
You can see how God can work through you and reach many other people.
I really wanted to make an impact in some way, but I just didn't know how. And then I started doing mission trips, and that really clicked something in my brain. I want to continue mission trips, not just because of traveling and getting to experience new cultures, but also to make an impact on people.
It is such a blessing that our students are able to have that opportunity through our schools, such as Mount Pisgah Christian Academy, but I know that so many of our schools are also doing such awesome mission work to be able to reach people around the world. I would love it if you would bow your heads with me as we close our education presentation with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this beautiful day with the sunshine outside, and thank you for blessing our conference with such a strong group of schools, with such a strong group of teachers, dear Lord. We know that our schools are one of the largest mission fields that we have, and that we are able to reach students every day, dear Lord, to be able to bring them closer to you and to be able to lead them to live a strong Christian life and to be able to mission and to be able to evangelize to others, dear Lord. Please continue to watch over our teachers and continue to watch over our schools. In your name we pray, amen.
Good evening. Are you ready to break some chains? I am. I want to be a part of that. The current number of individuals caught up in human trafficking is equal to the population of California. We have a very special magazine that we publish every time of year around this time, because July 30, as it's coming up, is the World Day Against Human Trafficking, and Child Impact is leading the charge against human trafficking for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. We have 16 projects in 12 countries. We have requests for 5 more projects. We want to put this special magazine into your hands. The story that we're going to be looking at on the video tonight is found on page 10, but right in the middle you will find an envelope, and on that envelope is a first-time opportunity for me to present this publicly to become part of the rescue party. What is the rescue party? Those are individuals that make a monthly donation to help with project, what we call Operation Child Rescue. That is what Child Impact is doing to fight human trafficking. So you'll see it just on the inside right here, how you can become part of the rescue party. So please check that out. It's explained also on the back page what that is. If you fill out the envelope, you can bring that by our booth tomorrow, or you can mail it in, either way, but we'd love for you to participate. Now I want to share with you what this chain is all about. The number of links in this chain is significant. How many links do you think there are? There are 100 links in this chain, and you notice one is different. What's different about that one? Only one out of 100 individuals that are trapped by human trafficking ever get rescued. That's an unbelievable statistic. It drives us to do what we do. Not only do we want to rescue individuals trapped by human trafficking, we also want to take preventative measures for those that are most highly at risk. Child Impact has a secret project. If you look on the back pages here, you will see a map of all of our projects fighting human trafficking, and you'll notice in the far right, it says secret project. You will have to come by the booth to hear what that secret project is. We cannot say that publicly. We cannot print that. But I would love to be able to share with you about that. So come by our booth tomorrow, and we'll be there, and I'll be able to share with you. Just ask me, what's the secret project, and I'll share that with you. I want to look at something with you tonight that is a significant project for us. It is our project that rescues the most girls. This project is focused on reaching 100 girls. Our initial investment was to rent a dormitory for girls who were being trafficked to truck drivers. And the video will explain this and what that's all about. But last year, every year, we have a major initiative where we have an infrastructure project. And last year, our project was to build a girls' dormitory for 100 rescued girls. The girls you will see in this video are some of the girls that have been rescued. This last year, as the dormitory has been built, we've rented a dormitory for 36 girls. So once that dormitory is completed, we will now have 100 girls that all are either involved, have been involved in human trafficking, or are at high risk for it. I'm going on Tuesday to visit the project, and I can hardly wait to see the progress that's been made. But I want to share with you a testimony very briefly of one of those girls that is now attending the school. This is an Adventist school. Somebody asked me yesterday, is this an Adventist organization? Yes, we are. We are moving onto the campus of Southern Adventist University this fall. We're located in Ottawa, Tennessee, and we've been around for decades as AsianAid. We became AsianAid USA, and then 7 years ago began to have an international ministry as Child Impact International. So here we are. This is one of the girls that's been rescued. This is her story. My name is Selena. I am the fourth born in a family of 5. There are 3 girls and 2 boys in my family. I started my education in 2013, but I started school late. and I was a bit older than the other children. I felt like dropping out of school many times. My parents still pushed me to go to school, and they tried hard to feed my siblings and me. All year, I was going to school with no shoes and no food for lunch or break because my parents could only afford to feed us for supper. So it should say breakfast. So she had no lunch, no breakfast. She only got supper. Sometimes they wouldn't even feed us at all. We would sleep without eating. So very tough situation in terms of poverty. But the story gets worse here. We later started a small vegetable garden, and we would sell vegetables by the roadside. You'll see this in the video. You will see in the video someone approached the girl and solicit her for prostitution. As our videographer was filming, this happened in real time. Couldn't believe it. He just kept the camera rolling, and you'll see that footage. So here it is. Sometimes men who drive trucks would want me to sleep with them for money. I'm ashamed to say I did it a few times so I could have something for food. I later took my grade 9 exam and passed. Then people from Riverside, this is a school we support that we're partnering with, where we're building the dormitory. The school from Riverside came and told me about people that sponsor children, that's child impact, and that I could be in school and have a place to stay and meals to eat. I am very grateful for everything that I've been receiving, and I'm working very hard to make everyone sponsoring me proud. So I want you to see that story. We still have a few children here at the booth that can be sponsored tomorrow. And I would also like to ask you to think about being part of the rescue party to help us grow this initiative within the Adventist Church to take a stand and fight against the evils of human trafficking.
I used to go at school in the morning, then knock off at 12, then go for prep, that's 2 p.m. to 4 p.m. Then at 5, I go and sell. Yeah, after 5, 7, we go at night. Yeah.
They've got no choice. They can't be watching their kids, sisters, and brothers starving. They have to go there. They've got no choice to say, if I stay at home, my kid sister will not eat anything.
Chirundu is a small town that borders Zimbabwe, about 1 hour from Riverside. And one characteristic that makes this town unique is the amount of traffic with large truckers that drive through for import and export. As we began to explore this area, we recognized a very vulnerable population in these communities. The vulnerable group that we discovered was teenage girls. Often the responsibility and the burden to take care of their elderly grandparents or their younger siblings rests upon these ladies at a very young age. Because basic needs are barely met, education is not a priority, and these girls have some very difficult decisions to make.
I'm not feeling so good to watch my young siblings not to eat because of not having enough money. You know, so I'm like, can I be a sacrifice? Something like that. Now you have trucks coming in and out of the town, and you know how sometimes these truck drivers, in the process of trying to relax, they approach girls, you know, to do certain things for them, and that girl will feel like, okay, fine, let me give in because I feel like they're going to give me what I'm looking for. The moment I get what I'm looking for, I'll be able to help out at home.
They go sell to the truck drivers. Later on, they go into the trucks, do something else. They're given money. They survive. Some of the girls that are taken are not even that of age. Some of them are 12, 13, 14.
By providing an education for these girls, we hope to intersect before they get to that high-risk age and be able to provide them a different hope and a different future.
I look at education to be a very important tool because it makes a lot of people be aware of certain things. You know how being educated, or rather just having an exposure of education, just alerts your mind, you know, like you just become alert of certain things, and Because you know that you're acquiring a certain skill, it exposes you to a lot of things. Imagine how you have an education and you've probably come across of certain things, the dangers of giving yourself to, you know, big men and everything. Like, trust me, you wouldn't really fall for it because you've already had an exposure. You've learned about such things. Someone has taught you the dangers of such things. So really an education in this case can really be helpful. It's really helpful to say it. It's really helpful to young women, young girls, especially.
Education is important, because look at me. It has helped me to become strong. Through that, I learned, because I put food on my table. Yeah, I paid fees through the bottles that I used to sell, the water. Yeah, so if any of these girls would do that, because they've been given an opportunity, what I would say to them is that they can just use it wisely, because it only comes once.
So imagine how a girl child gets an education, you know, they go back to their community and be an example to other children out there, be an example to their young ones. They become leaders, you know, they try by all means, you know, to make those young ones not to go back to the truck driver situation.
Our dreams for these girls is to be able to see their goals and dreams being fulfilled. Whether it's to be a faithful mother taking care of their own children someday or to become a doctor, we want to give them the opportunity. We are so thankful to be able to partner with Child Impact so that children and communities all around us can have lives that are mentally, physically, and spiritually fulfilling. This is our passion, and this is what drives our mission.
It's no longer putting food on their tables in survival, them becoming more strong women. Now they can focus on achieving their dreams.
Amen indeed. I'm Rebecca Stevenson. I'm with Adventist World Aviation, and it just so happens to be that I also moonlight as Opportunity. And here I am knocking yet again. Quick question, does anyone realize that AWA is actually 100% donor funded? Show of hands, anyone recognize that? Well, we are, and what's really exciting is that when we have a director of development, those funds that come in exponentially grow, and it allows us then as an organization to not only exponentially grow, but it helps us to go to all places in the world and do the kinds of things that you just saw featured with the last film. I have a challenge for you. If each of you would be willing to pray for Adventist World Aviation to find a director of development, a solid lead, someone who God has chosen, then please do so for the next week. Pray for that for us. I would so appreciate that. All of us there at AWA would appreciate that. So remember, contact me if you know of anyone or if you yourself are interested. My information is in the back here of the Carolina Today, Camp Meeting Today publication, or you can also reach me online at aa@flyawa.org. That email address again is aa@flyawa.org. God bless you all and enjoy your evening tonight.
Good evening, Carolina Camp Meeting family. Don't you just love that? Family. My name is Pastor Scotty, and I have the privilege of leading you in this evening's song service. I am the pastor of the Concord and Salisbury Seventh-day Adventist churches and also the Kannapolis church plant. And I want to say to those that are listening, wherever you are, God bless you and we love you with the love of Jesus. Our first song is Marching to Zion. Let us sing with a loud voice, Marching to Zion, like we're going to heaven. Marching to Zion.
Come we that love the Lord
Join in a song with sweet accord. Join in a song with sweet accord. And thus around the throne, and thus around the throne, we're marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to heavenly Zion, the beautiful city of God. The hill of Zion yields a thousand sacred sweets. Wonderful out there. Our next song will be one of my favorites, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Come Thou Fount.
Opening theme song, Savior Like a Shepherd. And indeed, He is our shepherd. Let us sing it together loud and clear. Let the heavens ring and give glory to His name. Savior Like a Shepherd.
Savior Like a Shepherd, lead us. Much we need Thy tender care. In Thy pleasant pastures feed us. For our use Thy folds prepare. Blessed Jesus, blessed Jesus, Thou hast brought us, Thou. Blessed Jesus, Thou hast bought us Thine. We are Thine, Thou dost befriend us, be the garden of our way. Keep Thy flock from we go astray. Oh.
Let us stand for our opening prayer.
Gracious God, you are our Savior. At the cost of heaven's wealth, you gave yourself to redeem us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your guiding us even to this point and bringing us here so that we may sing praise to you. Thank you for this gathering. We've come to meet with you, to worship you, and to be blessed by your presence. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Be seated. Good evening. It's nice to see a full house here on Friday evening. It's been a busy week. How many of you have been here all week? Good number of you. All right. Something special began to happen this afternoon. There was a calming. There was a quietness that began as we approached the Sabbath hours. And it's our desire that you experience the fullness of God's spiritual rest and physical rest as you are here together with us in this camp meeting 2023. There are a couple of things that I want to mention. One is that we are having the anointing service tonight in the Stone Chapel, and you are invited if you have a physical, spiritual, emotional concern that you want to submit to the Lord and be anointed, you're invited. I'm going to issue a special invitation to any ordained pastor here who would be willing to join us so that we have a number of individuals to help. So we will meet following this service in the Stone Chapel to your left. You can see it through the windows. Tomorrow morning, there will be two services, and we ask that if you come to the first service, you allow someone else to sit in your seat in the second service so that we can have as many individuals who would like to be here present. We look forward to that special time, and my understanding is, Pastor Bradshaw, you're going to be preaching the same sermon at both services. Okay, want to clarify that so that you don't think you're missing something. Okay? We are glad that you're here, and thank you for being members of the Carolina Conference and guests of the Carolina Conference. We realize there are a number of you who've come from nearby states and even beyond. So welcome here.
ASI is dedicated to networking, equipping, and empowering people like you, trailblazers for the gospel from all walks of life, visionaries and innovators who are looking to combine their skills and talents with the unique call God has given to us as his final movement. A call to prophesy again before many nations, a call to take the three angels' message into the marketplace in this generation. Join us as we take a closer look at the birth of ASI, its vision, mission, and purpose, and the ways in which you too can be a part of this trailblazing movement of innovative mission for God. On a warm summer's day in June 1904, the steamboat, the Morning Star, pushed away from the landing dock here in Nashville, Tennessee, and headed up the Cumberland River. On board was a small group of explorers setting out to find land. The group was on an expedition to find suitable land to build missionary training schools. These training schools were designed to deploy workers into the deep south of the United States. When they were a few miles out of Nashville, the Morning Star broke down right near this spot. Providentially, they had broken down on the edge of the Ferguson Nelson Farm, a large but unpromising spread of land near Madison. When they got to the land, Ellen White told Sutherland she had seen it in vision, and this was the land they should purchase for the training school. Sutherland's heart sank. He protested that it was far too big and far too expensive to be considered, but Ellen White remained adamant. This was the land. They begged God for help, for courage to move forward in faith, in obedience with the divine counsel. As they prayed, they were filled with such peace, assurance, and courage that from that point forward, whenever they faced challenges, they never doubted that God had called them to this place and to this work. Sutherland and McGann's faith, courage, and self-sacrifice were hallmarks of the work here at Madison. These traits permeated every facet of student life and provided an example for each cohort of students to follow. In many ways, Madison set the stage for innovation in mission in the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And not only that, it also facilitated and empowered lay-driven mission initiatives. Years later, when Adventist Laymen Services and Industries, better known as ASI, was formed, it too embraced these same core values: mission, innovation, and self-sacrificing commitment, all driven by an empowered and well-equipped laity. At the heart of the Madison model were a few key principles: the importance of faith in God's word and sacrifice, the importance of innovation and entrepreneurship within the context of mission, and the importance of an empowered and engaged church membership readily sharing Christ in the marketplace.
So sharing Christ in the marketplace is the motto of ASI. Every business has its own marketplace.
God has brought us where we are. Okay, He has helped us. He has given us the business and the opportunities. And so wherever we have that business, we share what He's given us.
The only way we could reach is Christ's method alone. The Savior mingled with men as one desire their good. He showed His sympathy for them, ministered to their needs, and won their confidence. Then He bade them, "Follow Me."
I think it's very, very important for us to open doors to be able to share the gospel. Our friend Dwight Hildebrandt says it best. He says, once you share Christ, it's like a disease and there is no cure, because you want to do it over and over and over again because it's such a joy.
Ministry has to take place beyond the walls of a church. And wherever you are, wherever you live, wherever you work, wherever you go to school, God wants you to do ministry.
ASI becomes the pulse, the very heart of what Adventism is all about. It is a lay movement. And I'm reminded of a statement of Ellen White where she said, until laity and ministry join hands, the work of God on earth will never be finished. And so it's vitally important.
On our own, we accomplish very little, but working together, empowered by the Spirit, God can use us to accomplish many times more. Ellen White wrote that the work of God in this earth can never be finished until men and women comprising our church membership rally to the work and unite their efforts with those of the ministers and church officers. This is precisely the mission and purpose of ASI: lay people and ministries working together to unite, gather, nurture, give, and send. If you are compelled to join this lay-driven movement of Seventh-day Adventist professionals, businesses, and supporting ministries with your time, efforts, and resources, we invite you to prayerfully consider becoming part of the ASI family. For more information on how you can join, go to asiministries.org.
Good evening, camp meeting family. I have here with me Arthur Gibbs, who is the ASI representative for North and South Carolina. And also, I've got here with me Robert Nunley, who is the VP or the Vice President for Projects for the Southern Union ASI chapter. And Arthur, I'd like to ask you a question. You know, I know that here in the Carolinas, I know you're affiliated with Fletcher Academy. You know, Fletcher has played an important role with ASI. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure, yeah. ASI was born right here in the Southern Union. In fact, both Pisgah and Fletcher Academy are charter members of ASI. Back in 1947 was when it was first started. And at the beginning, it was a lot of these, you know, supporting ministries of the Adventist Church, education outfits, health outfits that were banded together to support the mission of the church. But it's grown. It's now people who have businesses, might be a doctor with a doctor's office, might be a small business owner, might be somebody with 10, 20 employees. It's a variety of people who simply see a passion of working together and sharing Christ in the marketplace.
Now, I noticed that our ushers gave out some brochures to all of our members here about ASI, but what if somebody wanted to just say, hey, I would like to get involved with ASI? What would they do?
Yeah, so that website that they mentioned in the video, asiministries.org, would be a good place. Obviously, the brochure, if you don't get one of those, there might be some extras in the foyer. But I would encourage you to just come to one of the conventions. ASI is probably best known for its conventions. It has a national one. ASI is actually a part of the North American Division, Department of the North American Division. And they have one usually it's in the beginning of August every year. This year, I think it's August 2 through 5. It'll be in Kansas City, Missouri. You'd be welcome to come and join that. The Southern Union ASI also has a convention every year. It's often like in Gatlinburg area. I think we even had it in the Carolinas like 20 years ago, if I remember correct. So it's been a little while. But yeah, and you just come to those, and you'd be welcome to be a part of it. It's where a lot of people, it's kind of like a mini camp meeting. You've got music. Elder Louie comes there as well. And you have music, you have messages, and a chance to work on these projects together for mission.
I have gone to several ASI conventions, and every time I have gone, I have been so blessed to see the power of the lay people within the Seventh-day Adventist Church getting actively involved in ministry, and you just see a variety of them throughout the world. Well, why don't you tell us a little bit about what happens at these conventions?
Yeah, so there's obviously, you know, like I said there, you've got some speaking and you've got some music. They also have these projects, and that's just really a neat thing to see these things that literally are spreading the Three Angels message all around the world, and all these business leaders are banding together. Some of the seminars are very practical. You can do a lot of networking. You meet other business owners, other people who are professionals, and you get ideas on maybe marketing or outreach, how we can use our businesses, our connections with the community for Christ and His gospel.
Thank you so much. You know, Robert, you operate Pines Funerals and Cremations, and you have become actively involved with ASI. Tell me a little bit about how that all happened.
Well, I didn't know what ASI was, but it was here at camp meeting several years ago that it was you, Elder Louie, that mentioned it. And a few weeks later, I received a packet of information from you that had a lot of information about ASI. At that time, I was not a business owner, but I knew when I became a business owner, I was going to join ASI. So that's what I did.
Well, how do you share Christ in the marketplace? That's a theme that is of ASI, you know.
That's the exciting part about it. We look at ways that we can share Christ in the marketplace. And so I try to start with my staff, my employees. We've been able to begin a weekly Bible study at our office each week. And then we also, being a member of ASI, I let the staff know that we are part of a faith-based organization. We have to represent Christ in everything that we do. And it's nice having other believers working with us, even though they're not all Seventh-day Adventists, they are all believers, and they really support what we do.
If there was one thing that you'd like to share with our camp meeting family about what you like most about ASI, what would that one thing be?
Well, as a business owner, I can't go on mission trips. I can't do a lot of the things that are being done by these ministries all over the world. So being able to support them and then go to the conventions and see how the support that is being given is being shared all around the world is exciting to me. And being able to network with other people, we're all part of the same body of Christ. And when we see these people that are working out around the world in these different missions, and we're seeing the business owners that are helping support it, it's just really exciting to see how it works.
Well, thank you, Arthur. Thank you, Robert, you know, for sharing. ASI is a powerful ministry working for the church to spread the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let's support it with our prayers and our involvement. Let's finish this work together.
When you're in the hands of Satan,
you sometimes hear a voice in your head saying that something is not right. Today, I know this voice is the Holy Spirit. My name is Jose Antonio Carlon Cota, but my friends know me as Pepe. I work as a mechanic, fixing the trucks for a company that makes concrete. My life is a perfect example of a life restored by the mechanic of mechanics. Jesus Christ, through His grace, saved me, so I'm saved by grace. I grew up in an Adventist family, but in a way, very conservative. I don't judge my father, I don't judge my grandma. I know that their intentions were good. But I began to create a wrong idea about what the Adventist church is. This eventually became a problem, and with time, what I did was leave the church. Without even noticing, I began to hang out with other teenagers that in my mind were able to understand me. I began to go to a couple of parties, to hang out with my friends, to drink a beer. Just in the beginning, it was like I had a beer in my hand so they could see me holding it, just to belong. All of a sudden, I began to like beer, cigarettes, marijuana, and after that, I began to use heavier drugs. I was always high from 18 to 25 years old, and after that, it was when things started to get out of hand. I wasn't drinking and getting high socially. I had become an addict, that type that can't stop, can't say no. Evil doesn't have a limit. There is no place that you can say that you hit rock bottom, because I remember saying that I hit rock bottom 1, 2, 5 times, and it was always lower and lower. I became the worst person you could possibly imagine, without a doubt. And once I was there, I kept telling myself, I'm the worst, I'm despicable. There was a little voice that never left me alone. It kept saying, do you know what you're saying? You're bad, you're despicable. I remembered a Bible verse, still high, I began to read the Bible. Today I understand it was the voice of the Holy Spirit. So I began to read the Bible desperately, desperately. I took the Bible as if it was a life vest, like I was drowning and I was holding the Bible, like this I began to read the Bible, like it was the last opportunity, the last chance I had. I knew I was crazy. I knew that inside of me I was rotten. I knew that I had gotten to a point of no return. But something kept saying, God came for the vile and despicable. Search for Him. Search for Him. The first time I stepped into a church, after a while, I got to the church drunk, hungover, high, smelly. If you were at the church when I first got there, I had a baseball cap. Looking down, you could barely see my eyes, because in my mind, I could not look at God. I couldn't. I kept looking at my feet. I thought I couldn't. Something was telling me I could not look at Jesus. I got to the church ashamed. When I got to the church, someone greeted me, I suppose, but I did not understand any English. And when I got in, someone took my arm, and I remembered, I looked back and it was the only Hispanic person there. It makes no sense that there was a Hispanic person there. But he held my arm and said, are you looking for a Hispanic church? And I said, no, I just came to give my tithes. He took my phone and put in an address and told me they'll be waiting for you there. And I got to the church, and they had in front, when you walk in, literature for visitors or whoever. They had literature and the tithe envelopes. So I thought it was easy. I got the tithe envelope. But there's always something missing, always something that makes you have to talk to someone. I could not find a pen. Where's the pen? So I got a pen from a man named Ramiro. He said, welcome, come on in. Then he said, sit down. No, but I only came to give my tithe. There's no pen. He said, right now I'll get you a pen, but first sit down. So I sat down. So the first one I began to hear was Pastor Jonathan, who began to speak about God's grace. This brought to mind conflicts, emotions, memories, because I remember I could not even look up at that moment. But I don't know if he forgot about everyone else there.
I believe he was touched by the Holy Spirit because he did what God does. When someone comes and searches for Jesus, he ignores everything around him and asks, "Who touched me?" He focused on me, and in this moment I felt the theme of grace as if he was talking with me, as if God was telling me, "I'm not mad at you. I'm not mad at you. And I was waiting for you. I've been searching for you. I don't know if you noticed, but I was always close to you. I've always been close to you. If you're here, it is because I brought you here. I set you down here. I have this message for you, and I never want you to be far from me again." In that moment, I felt as if he was talking to me and as if no one else was around. It was though in the church it was just Jesus and me, and he was saying, "Do you know why I came to earth? I came to die for you." So then the next time I came to the church, there was participation in the rite of humility and the Holy Communion. I remember I got there and I looked at everything, and everything was familiar because I saw those things as a child. I said, "This is holy. I got to go." So I wanted to leave the church. But the brothers were at the door blocking the doorway. I said, "Excuse me." But they said, "Sit down. Sit down. It's all right." I did not want to participate, but the deacon was very persistent. He seemed like a nice guy, and he kept smiling at me, but he wouldn't move. He wouldn't move. So then I had to grab a small cup of the juice and the bread. Then I remember deep inside I told God, "I don't deserve it. You know that I don't deserve it." And then I remember telling God, "If you brought me here, it's because you know I don't want to do this because I don't feel that I deserve it. But if you tell me to do it, I will do it." So I did the rite of humility and the Holy Communion, and immediately I wanted to leave running, but I remember Brother Joel told me, "Come to wash your feet." So I felt what Peter felt when he said, "Now I understand this part. How can you wash my feet? Explain to me, if from everyone here in the church, I'm the worst. How can someone wash my feet? Can you explain to me? I can't stand the idea." And I told him, "No, I can't, brother. It's too much for me. Come, my child, come. If Jesus was here, Jesus would do it for you." I could not understand, but I accepted God's love and God's forgiveness. A few weeks later, they had an evangelistic campaign. We set a date for my baptism. It was for a certain date, but one day before, I was driving with my mom. We had a major accident, but we left like nothing happened, my mom and I. I remembered I prayed and I said, "This is the moment for me to get baptized." I'm not an example to be followed, but I believe that my testimony can be useful. I don't wish for anyone to go through what I've been through, but if the grace of Jesus Christ could rescue me, I don't believe you're in a place so low as I was. So if God saved me, you can be saved by grace.
We have witnessed the evangelistic efforts that are going on in the lives of Pepe tonight. We've witnessed the transformative power of evangelism in our own lives and in others. Through evangelistic efforts, we have seen hearts softened and lives changed. But there's still more work to be done, and we're called to be active participants in this mission. Today, every dollar given is an investment in the eternal destiny of someone who may be desperately seeking hope. Let us prayerfully consider what God has entrusted to us and respond with open hearts and cheerful giving. Thank you for your willingness to support the vital ministry of evangelism across the Carolinas. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I want to ask for a blessing upon the funds that are collected this evening for Carolina evangelism, that would be used across North and South Carolina to bring more people to you, that there would be more Pepes across our conference that would walk into a church and hear more about you. In your name, amen.
Aren't you glad for music that bears the wonderful words of life? Thank you. I hesitate to interrupt, but it is important that I share with you that there is an RV-type bus that is parked in front of the Crepe and Custard restaurant. I'm not sure exactly where that is. It's tag number KEB5524, and it's in a North Carolina tag. That will be towed by the Junaluska law enforcement if it is not moved now. So don't wait. Please go and take care of that. Tag KEB5524 if you parked a bus in front of the Crepe and Custard restaurant. Now, I'm not even sure where that is to tell you. Near the swimming pool. Okay. So please take note of that. The other thing that I've been asked to mention is that the Junaluska Assembly respects service dogs, but if your dog is not a service dog, they ask that it not be brought into the auditorium, and we want to be compliant with their request. So thank you very much.
We are so blessed as we welcome the hours of this Sabbath day to have Charles Hagebrooks as our singing evangelist. And many of you have heard him. He lives in Mount Dora, Florida. And Charles is married and has three children and three grandchildren. He has performed throughout the United States and in Canada and various parts of the world. He serves as a musical ambassador for Jesus Christ. And if you've heard him, you know that he sings with a heart filled with passion for Christ. And we welcome him as he shares the message of music.
Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise. It was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why he came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults and saw my needs. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. I once was blind, but now my eyes are open and I see. It was grace that set my spirit free.
Through many a day, dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come.
And it was grace that brought me home. I'll never know just why he ever came to love me so. He looked beyond my faults and he saw my needs. I shall cross where Jesus died for me. Alas, the grace that caught my falling soul. He looked beyond my fault. He looked my thoughts, he looked beyond.
We figured we needed somebody with as much passion as John Bradshaw. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Welcome to the final Sabbath weekend of Camp Meeting 2023. Take out your glow tracks, would you? Dear Jesus, in our hands we hold another seed of truth. This seed of truth says war in heaven. Much of the world doesn't understand that we're in a battle, Lord. They know that there's a conflict going on, but they don't understand the eternal consequences of that conflict. Oh God, I'm praying for every person here that's holding this seed of truth, that there will be a divine opportunity for them to plant this seed and reach a heart for heaven. In Jesus' name, amen. I am a teacher at heart, so I've got to give you a quiz, okay? All right, you ready? What was the very first Seventh-day Adventist television ministry? Anybody know? Faith for Today, I heard it right. For Faith for Today, that's right. What was the second television ministry of the Seventh-day Adventist Church? It is written. You're batting 100 here. All right. Who was the founder of the It Is Written television ministry? George Vandeman. How many speaker directors have we had with It Is Written? Boy, you guys are good. All right, four. All right, you just said George Vandeman was the first. Who was the second? Mark Finley. Who was the third? Sean Boonstra. And who was the fourth? The guy sitting right behind me here. We are just so honored to have John Bradshaw. And you know, tonight his message is going to be exactly our theme, seeking his face. Would you join me as we pray for him as he opens God's word to us? Loving Father, everything about this camp meeting has been focused on one thing, and that's to seek the face of Jesus. Bless your servant, Pastor John Bradshaw, as he opens the word of the living God. And now, Lord, open our hearts through your Spirit to receive that word. For we pray, Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Break me, melt me, mold me and fill me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you, Elder. Good evening, everyone. Great to be here with you tonight. Another wonderful day. Hope you had a great day at camp meeting. I sure did. How about that evangelism testimony a few moments ago? Wasn't that special? Not only was it fabulously made, but what a story. What a life-changing testimony. I hope you're encouraged by that. It Is Written began in 1956. Because evangelism, or for evangelism, is the whole reason that the ministry came into existence. And today, everything we do is focused around evangelism, and we are encouraged by that. Just a couple of things I want to tell you. I'm holding up two fingers, but there are actually three. But I know that if I say I have three things to tell you, you're going to look at your watch. If I say there are two things to tell you, this will just take a moment. You won't even check the time. I have two things to tell you. One is that if you're interested in evangelism training or you know somebody who is, if there's a young person in your church, irrespective of the age of that young person, just 3 hours from here is I want to say the premier evangelism training institute, but I don't want to sound immodest. But it's the premier evangelism training institute in North America. The faculty are outstanding. People who have been there and done that. Returned missionaries, former administrators, PhDs, evangelists. They even let me dabble with some of the training. Some of my staff at It Is Written, Wes Peppers, Eric Flickens, have years of experience not only in evangelism but in evangelism training. It's transformative. And so typically we have teenagers all the way through to teenagers in their 60s or maybe their 70s, and it is outstanding. If you would like to be part of SALT, let us know. Contact us at It Is Written and find out more. If you'd like us to come to you, we may be able to do that. We do something called Road SALT, and Road SALT is great. We take SALT on the road. And so we could come to your church or your district or your conference. Then there's Somersault, where we do what would you call it, a SALT intensive, and we're working on SALTines. That's SALT for young people. SALT is really making an impact, and I've seen several SALT graduates here this weekend, and that's outstanding. Another thing, this is number two of our 2 points I want to tell you. And this is that I just heard from somebody texted me, sent me a photograph. Look what we got in the mail. Did you send this or did someone else send this? We have a simple and inexpensive soul-winning device. It's called a mega mailer. Now, you've heard of these. You mail out Bible study interest cards into your community and then wait for people to send back the responses. So what happens is you send them out. They come back to us. Then we send them to you, and we don't want to study by correspondence with the people living two blocks away from your church. We want you to get to know them and go to their door, and then when they get to the testing truths, they know somebody, a friendly face. You can sit down and answer their questions and so forth. Grab a hold of the mega mailers. We've mailed out, look, I don't know, 1 million, 2 million, I don't know how many of these, and we get back an average of right around 10 per thousand. Ordinarily, you mail them out, you're happy to get back one per thousand. That's good. Two per thousand is great. My pastor friend said three per thousand. He said, he put his hands in there, he said, that's just Pentecostal. Well, I don't know what it is when we get back 10 per thousand. We had a little church, a little church of 30 people. They mailed out, 12,000 of these and got back 144? And 30 people going to church, they didn't know what they were going to do. One dear lady living in, I shouldn't say the state, because she spoke to a pastor and he said, no, this was in New York. And he said, no, we're not interested. She said, I'll mail them out myself. And when she got back 125 responses, she didn't know what she was going to do to keep up with them all. It's not always like that. I don't want to falsely represent this. That's an average of 10. So where somebody gets 12, somebody else gets 8. If someone gets 20, someone gets less. But when we were told by a pastor in Central California, they mailed them out in the wine country and got back 3.5 per thousand, we said, these are good. This is a way you can grow your church. And the second thing I want to tell you, because I'm only telling you two and not three, because three, you'd think I've been going a long time. And I know what you guys do to guys who go late. Listen, by the way, I had representatives of the Cameron DeVasia Defense League come to me as a delegation today. Now, I wasn't knocking Cameron, the guy that I was told went about 3 a.m. two nights ago. I was just feeling liberated because I figured the guy preached so long, I can just preach till I'm hoarse and I still won't go that long, so I felt like I was in a happy place. But the Cameron DeVasia Defense League came to me. The Cameron DeVasia Anti-Defamation League came to me. And they said, oh, he got started late. Yeah, brother. Yeah. What a lily-livered excuse. Got started late. I said, well, he can't have got started at 8:30. They said he got started at 8:15. Do you know what the time is right now? They say that history never repeats. I'm afraid it does. So the second thing I want to tell you is this. My wife, who's sitting down here, my wife, Melissa Bradshaw, who is a graduate of Fletcher Academy. How about that? We have some Fletcher Academy people here. Actually, their most outstanding graduate of all time, as a matter of fact, and certainly the most beautiful graduate ever to come from Fletcher Academy. Sorry, the rest of you, but, you know. Anyway, Melissa leads children's ministries at It Is Written, and that is evangelism. Now, she's produced something that you can use in an evangelistic series. You know when you have an evangelistic meeting and you need a program for the kids. We've created, Melissa has created something called Buried Treasure. It's outstanding. It's based on the gold standard Bible study for kids, the My Place with Jesus Bible Guides, which Melissa wrote and produced. It features some of the Buried Treasure or children's songs, 25 or so original scripture songs, and they're all fantastic. Melissa wrote 22. Our daughter wrote one. A friend's kid wrote one, and we stole one. That makes up 25. We didn't steal it. We borrowed. In fact, we tried to find out who wrote it. We tried and tried and tried and tried and tried. Couldn't find out. We use it like, sorry. So if you wrote it, thanks. Thanks. So the songs are terrific. There's crafts and funny games and this and that and Bible study. And children love it. And it's brand new and it's fresh and it looks great and it's really great. So keep that in mind if you're looking for something for a children's program. We've had people get a hold of that resource and do it at home. They said, we want to do this with our kids at home, and homeschoolers have used it. So anyway, that's Buried Treasure, an evangelism resource for kids. In addition to that, because what we believe is that connecting people with young people with Jesus is better than entertaining young people, Melissa has put together, what a great idea, Journey Through the Bible. It's a Bible reading plan for kids. And we incentivize it a little bit. At the end of the month, the kids finish their reading. They let us know. We send them the collectible stickers. I mean, this is back to the future. Mums and dads, get your children reading the Bible. It's the most exciting book they'll ever read, and they will love it. Sabbath school teachers, instead of just getting the kids in the door and sending them home and wondering why next week they haven't grown at all spiritually, get them onto Buried Treasure. They'll read 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 Bible verses a day, and they're suitable for the kids. Now, love them. Kids will begin to grow. Feed them right. They'll grow, and they'll grow strong. So two of the many things I could tell you about at My Place with Jesus, our children's ministry, It Is Written, but one is Buried Treasure, an evangelism program for children, and a Journey Through the Bible, which is a Bible reading plan, and I'm very grateful for what Melissa is doing at It Is Written. Anyway, why don't we pray, and we will not look at the time again. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we're encouraged tonight. What a wonderful testimony we saw earlier. A gentleman named Pepe, who described himself as the worst of the worst, and you saw in him something that could be redeemed. And we thank you that you look on all of your children in the same way. We are truly, truly grateful. We've been encouraged tonight, too, with the focus on ASI, to think about a ministry in the marketplace. And we are grateful. We're thankful tonight that we can spend a few moments thinking about It Is Written, ministry going to the world through television and radio and the internet and resources and training and children's ministry and so much else. We're thankful. We thank you for the work being done here in the Carolina Conference, a conference that is evangelistically focused, planting churches, revitalizing churches, growing your kingdom. And so tonight in this beautiful place, right on the doorstep of the Sabbath, we are grateful for your presence with us. Would you speak to us tonight and bless us, we ask you. Somehow manage to hide this faulty human instrument so that Jesus can accomplish something for his kingdom, something meaningful in our hearts and lives. We pray, thanking you in Jesus' name. Please say with me, amen. I want to tell you, I am especially encouraged by this year's camp meeting theme, Seeking His Face. For essentially, our camp meeting theme is a brief synopsis of the essence of the Christian faith. To be a Christian is to seek His face. So what are we talking about here? Seeking His face. We are contemplating the idea of actually and intentionally looking for Jesus, not merely milling about, hoping we might bump into Him. We're not wishing that we would encounter Jesus unexpectedly. We are wrestling with this idea of actively seeking. Our theme encompasses the idea of doing something intentional, calculated, premeditated. You seek Jesus here. That is something you do on purpose. To seek is to look for something, to search for something. To say to search, is that too strong? I don't think so. We are actively seeking, actively looking for, actively searching for, in this case, the face of Jesus. And we could think of people in the Bible who did that. The wise men who came from the east. Where is He that is born King of the Jews, they asked. We have seen His star in the east and are come to worship Him. What's significant about that is that the star that the wise men saw was up there in the sky. It was not hidden below the tree line. It was not hidden around the dark side of some old storage building. Anyone could have seen that star. Everyone, I might say, did see the star, but only a few gave it any notice, even though that star was placed there deliberately by God as the fulfillment of a prophecy made by a rascal named Balaam many hundreds of years before. Israel had one job, really, and that was to be ready for the advent of its Messiah, our Messiah. But when the prophecy was fulfilling in their very midst, even though the sacred oracles pointed them to this specific moment in time, they were totally oblivious to what was going on in the sky and to what was going on in a little village named Bethlehem, just a couple of miles away, when it should have been front and center in their minds. The birth of the Messiah was something about which they had absolutely no clue. Now, of course, there were many others who sought Jesus, and we'll get to some of them. But what's interesting about our camp meeting theme is that it states not merely that we are seeking Jesus, but that we are seeking His face. You read that. You read that in the camp meeting advertising and the literature and so on, and you didn't really stop to think about it because it's just a phrase that we use. We're seeking His face. It's like being washed in the blood. We just accept that. If you were a non-Christian, you might look quizzically when somebody uses a statement like that. We're seeking His face, but if you think that through, that's simply another way of saying we are seeking His presence. We are actively looking for, searching for the presence of Jesus. And surely that would mean looking to be in the presence of Jesus, looking to spend time in the presence of Jesus. We must be looking to experience the presence of Jesus. But ladies and gentlemen, here is our challenge. We live in a world that demands our attention and that conspires against faith in God. Without wanting to get political, it'd be so easy to say something and be branded as political. Don't want to do that. But we're living in a world now where down is up and up is down, and nobody seems to question that. We're living in a world now where the strangest things not only happen but are promoted, yea, verily, they are accepted. The strangest thing. And so this world is a world that is mired in the great controversy. Now, I'm going to suppose that you have read the book of Revelation or much of it. And that book tells us that the dragon, who? The dragon, was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. The devil is at war with the church. Peter wrote that your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour. You are in his crosshairs. You have a target on you. Maybe it is a cross-shaped target. The devil hates you and your children and your grandchildren, hates your pastor, hates your church, wants to see us all gone. We exist in that milieu, you understand. That's where we find ourselves. The dragon, the devil, was wroth, angry with the woman, and the woman is the church. The woman is the church. Let me share something from my experience. I was not yet a member of the church. I was living on what for me then was the other side of the world, living in London, England, and I attended a church in the center of the city, just a couple of blocks up from Piccadilly Circus, wonderful church at the time, wonderful. And I got in that church and I looked around and I thought, well, look at all these people. They got one foot on the sea of glass and one foot on a banana peel. They are the most sanctified people that I could ever even imagine. The pastor says, let's turn in our Bible to the book of Zechariah. They turn there like that. I didn't even know there was a book of Zechariah. It's like magic. Now let's sing a hymn. Everybody sung. Like, by the way, the singing tonight, fantastic. You know what? I don't mean to get on anybody's case. We don't need new music. We just need the music that we do to be done well. And everybody will love that. No one can argue with how you sang tonight. That was beautiful, and it touched everybody's heart here. And so everybody sang, and it was time to pray, and they prayed. And the pastor, when he prayed, actually sounded like he knew the person he was talking to. It was fantastic. And I thought I would never been closer to heaven, and that was probably true. And then I realized, well, there's some funny things going on around here. Because I have a friend in the church, and every time a pretty girl walks by, have you ever seen the way an owl can turn its head? This brother, I swear to you, was part owl. And then we had a fellow over here, Brazilian guy, who turned out he was running around on his wife. And I thought, hang on, that never even happened in the Catholic church that I attended, at least not that I knew of. And then, and it got worse. The young lady teaching the Sabbath school lesson, she was obviously a feminist, and not that that's necessarily a bad thing. Turned out she was a lesbian, and I wondered, what about that? That didn't seem right. Well, yeah, church dealt with some of these things as it moved by, don't worry. I wondered if somehow I got the directions wrong, if God had sent me to the wrong place. I thought, hold on a second. I came out of a church that didn't have half of these problems, at least not to the naked eye, and these people are misfits and dysfunctional, some of them, and it shouldn't be that way. And I think it's true. It shouldn't be that way, but we're all sinful, and we're broken, and we're hurting, and so you get some of that. And God showed me Revelation chapter 12 and verse 17. He said, John, I have something to tell you. The dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, those that keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. And it made sense then. Of course, we are going to see some challenges in our midst because the devil is at the top of his game. He's seeking to pick people off. Never has the world been more sinful, in modern times at least. So, ladies and gentlemen, if you see discouraging things in the church, don't get mad. Just understand that an enemy has done this. Isn't that right? That's what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 13. You can look with compassion on the sinful folks who aren't nearly as holy as you. Instead of looking down your nose and being judgmental, you can say, there but for the grace of God go I. We are living in delicate times, in stressful times. The devil is angry. And why is he angry? Well, we read it. Because the remnant of her seed, God's remnant in earth's last days, keep the commandments of God. The devil hates that. He does not want you or anybody else faithfully following God. Doesn't want you taking the Ten Commandments seriously. He doesn't want that. If you love me, Jesus said, keep my commandments. And we struggle to understand how Christians of other stripe will read the Ten Commandments and see nine. Or we'll take the fourth commandment and say, it's okay that we scrambled that one around. We battle with that. We'll let God deal with that, and we'll share our faith gently and kindly, I would hope. Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Paul wrote, love is the fulfilling of the law, because love leads to obedience. Love for sin leads to compromise. Love for the world leads you to look at the will of God with less respect. Had a dear friend one day, and she said, it is my mission to show others, that's non-Christians, that we are just the same as them. Don't say amen. Because I want to tell you, based on the authority of Scripture, we are not just the same as them. We have been redeemed. We have been, to coin a phrase, washed in the blood of the Lamb. We have encountered Jesus. We have surrendered our hearts. The Bible says that we are a peculiar people, not weirdos, but purchased, peculiar. Jesus is the difference maker. Can you say amen? Surely he is. The devil is angry because here's a group of people who have given their all and they keep the Ten Commandments. Ladies and gentlemen, the law of God is important. Sin is deadly. It leads to death. We should not broker any kind of happy peace deal with sin. It needs to go. It's what nailed Jesus to a cross. You know that obeying God's law doesn't make you a legalist. It makes you a Christian. We should not have to explain that to one another. We love God. We are drawn to God by faith. Jesus then lives his life in us, and he leads us to walk in his pathway because he has our hearts. Now, I'm going to take a risk here, but I just will, because why not? It is easy to talk to Seventh-day Adventists about keeping the commandments of God because we all agree with that, don't we? Thank you, Jesus. We all agree with that, don't we? We all agree with that, don't we? But do we all agree with that at 12:45 on Sabbath afternoon when we're running off to Shoney's? Do we? No, we don't. No, we don't. That's not progressive. That's sin. That's sin. Just as. And if you don't like me telling you that, well, I'm really glad, because evidently the Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart. Ladies and gentlemen, if I don't tell you, your pastor's probably too scared to tell you. And ordinarily we don't talk about this at camp meeting, because who in the world wants to out themselves and sound like some old-fashioned fuddy-duddy? But I love you, and I want to see you saved. And I'm not telling you you're lost, but I'm telling you that if you keep on going down that road, there's a pretty fair chance you will be. We are Seventh-day Adventists, right? And people say, what's the difference between us and you? And our answer is, well, what are the similarities? Let's talk about the similarities first, because we are so like you Methodists. We're so like you Baptists. We are so like you Pentecostals. We've got so much in common. That's all true. But the point of difference is the seventh-day Sabbath, that we understand it's going to be a test down at the end of time. And if you are choosing to fail the test now, tell me how you're suddenly going to straighten up and pass the test down at the end of time. No, we're not saved by Sabbath keeping. Never. No one ever was. We are saved by grace through faith in Jesus. That's the only way. But if you love me, he said, you'll keep my commandments. You're not going to dumb them down. You're not going to treat them cheaply. Ladies and gentlemen, let's show the world, more importantly, let's show Jesus, and let's show ourselves that we take this thing seriously. We believe in commandment keeping, not commandment breaking. I'm willing to say amen. I want to encourage you to treat God's law with the sacredness it deserves. The devil is behind all of the watering down of God's law. People keep the commandments of God. The devil hates that. Of course he does. But there's something else in that verse, and I kind of easily brushed over it. The dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her seed that keep the commandments of God. Now think very carefully, please. That keep the commandments of God. The very next word in that verse is what? That keep the commandments of God, that's one, and the testimony of Jesus Christ. You have read Revelation 19 and verse 10. And so you know that the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy, the spiritual gift of prophecy. The devil is angry with the remnant church because we are in possession of the end time manifestation of the gift of prophecy. The devil hates the idea of God's people reading and listening to and being guided by the spirit of prophecy. My brother, my sister, I would appeal to you, don't go soft on the spirit of prophecy. Can you say amen? This is no time for that. We are living in earth's last days, and God specifically gave us special guidance, special guidance. We want to read those books given to us by God. Read the Conflict of the Ages series. Read Patriarchs and Prophets. It'll grow your faith. Read Prophets and Kings. It'll blow your mind. Read The Desire of Ages. You will look straight into the face of Jesus. Read Acts of the Apostles. You will be energized for evangelism. Read The Great Controversy, and you will see this world through new eyes. You want to read these books. They will change your life. They will draw you to the heart of Jesus. They will provide insight. They'll reveal Christ and strengthen your heart. Read the testimonies to the church. It says on the front cover, it's to the church. Don't answer out loud. But when was the last time you even held one of those books in your hand? Let me do a little unsolicited piece of advertising for the ABC. If you don't have the testimonies at home, before camp meeting's over, stop by the ABC and buy them. I hope they run out. If they do, give them your name, phone number, and credit card number and say, send me a set when you order more in. You will read your story in there 1,000 times. I'm reading my way through the testimonies again. I'm reading small chunks, but consistently. And I sit in my office the other day, and I thought, man, I don't have time for this. I'd like to read just a few pages. And some voice said to me, it had to be the voice of God, you need to read that today. No, I don't have time. You need to read that today. Okay. And I knew I was going to read something there. And I opened up that thing and I started reading. Oh, have mercy. It wasn't written to me, but it was speaking to me. And I said, ouch. I needed to read that because it's true and you wanted to communicate something to me. And so I'm thankful to God. Read them. Read Christ's Object Lessons. You won't find a more profoundly theological book than that. Steps to Christ, greatest book on righteousness by faith outside the Bible. Read Thoughts from the Mount of Blessing. Read Education. Ladies and gentlemen, God inspired the writing of these books for you. And even if you're not a church member, God wants you to know, grab a hold of these books. Read them. They will grow your faith in God and help prepare you to be ready for the second coming of Jesus. The devil hates the idea of us reading those books. Hates them. And then we even hear voices in the church. Oh, they're really not that important, those books. Oh, yes, they are. Someone's going to say to someone here tonight, I cannot believe this guy's stuck in the mud talking about reading them old books. Someone's going to say that. Surely. Friend of God, thoughts and comments like that were never inspired by God. Not even once. And I don't want you saying, I would rather read the Bible, like you've never read anything else. It's not a matter of either or. This is both and. You can read more than one thing in your life, you understand. Surely you understand that. Don't make the mistake of neglecting the Bible. Of course not. But God has wanted to guide us safely to the other shore. And he gave us this special gift because it's for our good. And then along comes a scholar. I love it, man. It's like clockwork. Every so often, there'll be another one come along, say the same old dumb stuff that was said decades and decades ago. Oh, that great controversy? She was just influenced by the anti-Catholic sentiment of her time. No, she wasn't. She was influenced by the Holy Spirit of Almighty God. You've been influenced by the anti-truth sentiment breathed on you by the devil. We don't need scholars like that. In fact, that's not scholarship. Scholarship doesn't contradict what the Bible teaches. That's just foolishness. That's all that is. So when a scholar comes to you, and not many of them will do that, but every so often another one comes along, scholar comes to you sneering on the life and ministry of Ellen White, you know that the best thing you can do is run in the other direction. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a gift given to us by God, and we ought not neglect that. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not campaigning to have someone canonized. I'm simply saying, be sure that you allow that special gift given you by God to occupy appropriate importance in your life and in your experience. Don't neglect that gift. And by the way, do yourself a favor and your kids a favor. Teach your children to read the Spirit of Prophecy and encourage them to do so. Kids are in a life and death battle today. It is an absolute zoo out there, and you know that. So encourage your kids. And by the way, don't be a crank. Don't be an extremist and say, oh, we did this because Ellen White said so. You don't want to be that. In days gone by, we kind of pressed a little too hard with us, and we drove people away. And today, we're not pressing at all, and so they're just running away. Encourage your kids. Read together from The Desire of Ages. Read something from The Great Controversy. Read something from Acts of the Apostles. It's important. And please, don't take things out of context. Be balanced. Now, I was reading the other day, and I read where Ellen White had written, my sister, what does she say? I had this ready to go. She said, eat less than you do. Now, she did not say that to me, I promise you. That's not what I read. That was for somebody else. But you could read that and say, well, listen, I have to take that. She's speaking to me. Maybe you don't. Remember, time and place. Who was being addressed? Who was being spoken to? What were the circumstances? We don't need any more extremists in the church. We got more than our fair share. So keep it straight. Keep it in the Bible. Keep it in the Spirit of Prophecy and be guided by God. Can you say amen? We're in a battle for our souls. It's a tough battle and it's intensifying. We want to grow our faith in God because the devil is playing for keeps. He is serious about all this. Why don't I add another thought while I'm at it? Let me add this. And the dragon was wroth with the woman and went to make war with the remnant. I remember sitting in a minister's meeting, not in this union, not in this time zone. And I was sitting there and I heard a young hotshot minister at the table next door. He was a guy that the conference had brought in because he was the next big thing. And I couldn't help overhearing him when he said, oh yeah, you know, I believe what the church teaches. That was a relief. But then he said, but you know what, I just don't believe that we are the remnant. He said, I don't believe that. And I heard him say that and I said to myself, he will soon be out of the church. Unfortunately, I was right. Last I heard, I asked a friend of his, he's now living with there's a name for these guys. He's living with a Brahmin, a New Age spiritualist teacher. He's as far from God as he possibly can be. My friend said, I had to cut the conversation short. He said, I just couldn't handle all the swearing on the other end of the telephone. We have to understand something. This shouldn't make us arrogant, shouldn't make us proud, but God has raised up a remnant. That's to be the repository of God's end time message, the three angels' messages. Now, that message is going to go to the world, the whole world. Now, you can go to any other Christian church in the land, and they are our brothers and sisters in Christ, genuine Christians who love Jesus with all their heart. But not the remnant. God has given to us the three angels' messages. He has given to us a work that he hasn't committed to any other church. He's given to us the message of preparing a people to be ready for the return of Jesus. Now, how's that going? Okay, before we start congratulating ourselves, there's 20-odd million of us and 8 billion people in the world. All right. I had this discussion once with a lady in our church. We were asked to rent our church to a Sunday church. And she said, Pastor, we would be allowing Babylon in our church. I said, hey, let's open our Bibles together. We went to Revelation chapter 18, and God said, come out of her. I said, they're God's people. She said, okay, I'm in. I vote yes. So it's not us and them. There are Christians all across the landscape. But friend, God has called us to a special work. He has commissioned us to a work in his wider vineyard that he's given to nobody else. I'd love to tell you exactly how the gospel is going to go to the end, go to the world before the end of time. I'd love to be able to tell you that, but I don't have that roadmap. I just know it will. I got some ideas, but I just know it will. By the way, COVID, what did COVID teach you? COVID taught you that something no one had ever heard of can be known by everybody everywhere in the world in about 6 weeks. Now is anybody wondering how the gospel is going to go to the world? No, no, no. We see it. I conduct evangelistic meetings with some regularity, not as much today as I used to. We would teach about the mark of the beast, and people would say to us, I see what you're saying. I get it. I even believe it. And then they'd say, but how is that going to happen? Since COVID, we preach about the mark of the beast. Nobody asks that question. Everybody knows you can take an issue and make it known globally, virtually overnight. This gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness to all nations, and then shall the end come. It is going to happen. God has given us that work. He differentiates us in that respect. We are distinctive. We must never forget that God has given us a special work to do. Can you say amen? Amen. All right. And so I wonder if we can consider this. The only thing that can keep us in this great controversy is not a thing, but a man. And that man is Jesus. We want to be seeking his presence, seeking his face. We can't get by without Jesus Christ and his righteousness. So I wonder if our camp meeting theme is encouraging us to seek, to search for, to be proactive about living lives of commitment before God. Can we be grown up enough to acknowledge that God would have us take seriously the tenets of our faith? I think he would want that. It was Jesus who said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. The tendency today is to be swept along with the culture in which we live in the midst of. You know, as a kid, I used to go to the beach with some frequency. We'd get in the ocean and we'd swim around and we'd play around out there. Then we'd come out of the ocean and invariably we were a couple of hundred yards down from where we got in. You know that happens, right? You get into the ocean and you drift. You get carried along in the current and you don't even know it happens. It happens imperceptibly. And by virtue of being in the world, we can drift today imperceptibly. When you drift, you get further from Jesus. You become more like the world without even realizing that, looking less like a Christian and more like every other person who professes no faith in God at all. Now, maybe 24 times or more, I checked, more than 24 times, the Bible encourages us to seek the Lord. In those words, seek the Lord. 1 Chronicles 16, verse 11, seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face continually. And that's the same real estate is occupied by Psalm 105 and verse 4. It says the same thing. God is urging us to be proactive about searching out his presence and spending time there. Time in the presence of God will change you, will mold you. We cannot be Christians without taking time to pray and read, without being active in ministry, sharing our faith. This is a real thing. Now, Moses gave us an example. Unwittingly, Moses went up into the mountaintop with God. He spent 40 days and 40 nights there. It came to pass, Exodus 34 says, when Moses came down from the Mount Sinai with the two tables of testimony in his hand, he came down from the mount and didn't know that the skin of his face shone while he talked with God. Sorry, it was Aaron actually. And when Aaron and all the children of Israel saw Moses, behold, the skin of his face shone, and they were afraid to come near him. He had sought God's face and been in his presence. Until Moses had done speaking with them, he put a veil on his face. Moses, you've been in God's presence. You are shining too brightly for us now. You have to veil that. We can't even look on you. What a thing. He'd been in God's presence. Didn't you read in the New Testament? They took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. It makes a difference, not just to your countenance, but it makes a difference to your heart, you understand. He'd been there on the mountaintop. He had been in the presence of Jesus. And I'm going to give you a verse and then run over to the book of Revelation. 2 Corinthians chapter 3:13. And we are not like Moses, who used to put a veil over his face so that the sons of Israel would not stare at the end of what was fading away. Verse 18. But we all with unveiled face, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as by the Spirit of the Lord. And by the way, we can talk about rights and wrongs until the cows come home. We can. How to do this and whether God wants that and what the Bible says about this. But nothing will make that effective in our experience unless we are spending time face to face with God. That's where transformation comes from. And my brothers and sisters, we are to be transformed before Jesus returns. Yea, verily, we can know that that will be a reality in our experience. Because in Revelation chapter 18, where we read about the fourth angel, it says, after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, listen, and the earth was lightened with his glory. What this is telling us is that before Jesus comes back, the earth will be illuminated with a manifestation of the character of God. It will be seen in God's people. This is what God is calling us to, not to be just like everybody else, not to be as close to the world as we can possibly be, but to distinguish ourselves from everything else because we have been with Jesus. It must change us. It must transform us. It will if we take that time. We are to seek his face, not because it's a good religious idea, not because it's simply a slogan we put on the advertising this year, but because that was prayed about and thought through by people who want all of us to be transformed as we spend time in the presence of Almighty God. Can you say amen? In God's presence, Daniel fell down as dead. God's presence will cure us of self-confidence and self-satisfaction. When you see God in his greatness and his majesty, everything changes. Daniel said, my comeliness was turned in me into corruption, and I retained no strength. There's a Bible verse that says, read the word to your children, rising up early. Put it on your doorposts and between your eyes. Ladies and gentlemen, that's the word of God. Listen, you won't drive to the post office without putting your seatbelt on. Good idea, but you will start your day without reading the Bible, without fortifying your mind with the presence of God. When did you last pray that God would fill you with his Holy Spirit? If it wasn't this morning, then it's way too late. Think about what you're doing. You are going through life telling God, I'm good. You don't need to bother sending your Holy Spirit into my heart. I can take care of this. No, you cannot. We need Jesus desperately. And God has promised he will give the Holy Spirit to us in answer to our simple request. We just ask and he will do it. God is more willing to give the Holy Spirit to us than we are willing to give good gifts to our children. Friend of God, we are so close to the return of Jesus. So close. We don't have time to dilly-dally around anymore. We got to seek his face while there is still time. Receive of his Holy Spirit. Connect with God through the word. Be strengthened through prayer. And be certain that Jesus is living his life in us. It is the presence of God we need. Hey, you didn't expect to come to camp meeting and have somebody in the evening meeting tell you something as basic as Look after your devotional life. Take time to pray every day. There's a reason you lose your temper. It's not because of your father's DNA being in your life. It's because you are not spending time in the Word. It's that simple. There's a reason your mind wanders off onto unholy ground. That's because you're not praying. Friend, we are talking about going to heaven and inhabiting mansions that Jesus is building for us. And we'll discuss the chiastic structure of the book of Revelation. And we'll become self-proclaimed experts on the sanctuary. All that's okay. But if you are not praying, who are you fooling? Nobody at all. All these cranky folks in church who want to argue about everything. Ask them what they're hiding. There's a reason people act like the devil. It's not because, oh, that's just old Bob. He's just like that. No, old Bob is not praying. And old Bob is not reading his Bible. And old Bob thinks he's going to go to heaven just like he is. He's going to wake up on the judgment day mighty surprised. Friend, the last sands are falling through the hourglass of time. And you know that I don't know how much time we actually have left, but I think we all agree it's not much. And by the way, consult the date of birth on your driver's license. And in all this talk about the return of Jesus being soon, it's soon no matter how you cut it for most of us, because we don't have awfully long. Jesus is appealing to us tonight to allow him to have our hearts so he can own us and redeem us and save us and prepare us for eternity. We can be doing nothing that's more important than seeking the face of God. It's God's presence we need, more of his presence. Did you ever think about the story where Jesus entered the temple? Went to the temple, turned over the money changers' tables, had this cord he waved in his hand, get these things hence, and wonder of wonders, they did what he said. Did you ever wonder why, when he wasn't big and tall like Saul, he wasn't big and strong like Samson, he was just ordinary man. And in he went, and he cleansed the temple. There's a lesson for us in this, because I'm going to read you a little passage from The Desire of Ages. No, I won't read the passage. I'll just get to the point. It says at the end of the passage, this is page 158. Officers of the temple, speculating priests, brokers and cattle traders with their sheep and oxen rush from the place. Now, this is really interesting. Why would the sinners flee the temple? They were making money in there. I wouldn't dare you to, but someone might dare you to try this in Las Vegas. Go in there and turn over the roulette wheel and turn over the blackjack table. Get these things hence. They'll get you hence. Why was Jesus able to get away with it? Well, we just read about various groups of people. They rushed from the place with the one thought of escaping from, listen to this, the condemnation of his presence. It was his presence that drove them from there, which says to me, that if the presence of Jesus can drive sinners from the temple, then if my body is the temple, if my heart is a temple, the presence of Jesus must drive the sin from my life. I need the presence of Jesus. I gotta take time with Jesus, and Jesus will fix me up and straighten me out. I want you to think of some of those who sought Jesus' presence, those who sought his face. When blind Bartimaeus learned that Jesus was nearby, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. They tried to silence him, but the man cried even louder. And Jesus says, what do you want me to do for you? The man said, Lord, that I may receive my sight. Jesus said, go your way. Your faith has made you whole. Immediately, he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. Wherever Jesus went, I don't know how long, but he was Bartimaeus, not blind Bartimaeus, but 20/20 vision Bartimaeus, who was healed and received precisely what he wanted because he sought the face of Jesus. Then there was the woman who touched the hem of Jesus' garment. What's interesting is that Jesus was in a crowd of people all bumping into him as he went. And he stopped and he said, who touched me?
Strangest thing you'll ever hear. They even said, Master, there's a whole crowd of people. Everybody's touching you. No, no, no. I perceive that virtue has gone from me. Woman had been sick 18 years. Doctors couldn't help her. She sought the face of Jesus, and she would never be the same again. Come on and say amen. This is what Jesus can do. Only Luke chapter 19 tells the story of Zacchaeus, a wealthy tax collector and an enemy of his own people because he was an agent for the occupying Roman power. Bible says he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and couldn't because of the crowd, because he was little of stature. And he ran before and climbed up into a sycamore tree. Man, you can't roll out of bed half an hour early to read your Bible. And here's Zacchaeus wearing his, I don't know, what's that? I can't remember the designer. We'll call him Christian Dior. Wearing his Christian Dior clothes. I can't see Jesus, so I am going to climb a tree. Not a dignified thing for the man to do. But he had to see Jesus. Climb the tree. Got a bird's eye view. And Jesus called Zacchaeus down. He said, I'm coming to your house today. And Zacchaeus was transformed. He sought the face of Jesus. Jesus knew what was going on. He met with Zacchaeus, and this life was transformed. 10 lepers. If you had leprosy, you were an outcast. You were hopeless. It was a death sentence. But 10 lepers came to Jesus, and they said, we want you to help us. That was bold in a time that lepers were supposed to sequester themselves away. And all 10 of them were healed. One, a Samaritan, came back to thank Jesus. The other 9 went in their own way, you understand. Friend of God, if you will seek his face, you will receive healing, maybe physically, definitely spiritually. If you will seek his face, you will be transformed. If you seek his face, he will be found of you. It will show in your life and in your experience, there may be something missing in your life. And it's as simple as praying and reading the Bible and inviting Jesus to fill your heart with his presence. He will do it. It will cost you nothing. And he will do it always and every time. Friend, God wants more from us, more for us, than the highest human thought can think. He can do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think. If we seek his face and ask that God would touch us and change our hearts. Imagine winning the Powerball Mega Millions lottery and having that ticket worth tens or even hundreds of millions of dollars in your pocket and deciding that you wouldn't cash it out. I mean, no one would be able to understand that. You have everlasting life in your hands. All you got to do is cash it out. Simplest thing in the world. And thank God Jesus never asked us to climb a mountain or swim an ocean in order to be saved. Just surrender. Allow Jesus to live his life in you and everything will change. Philippians 1 and verse 6. He who has begun a good work in you is faithful to perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. I should have spoken more about this tonight. I'll pick it up tomorrow night. We miss righteousness by faith. Too many of us still believe we've got to somehow work our way to heaven or prove ourselves to God, when the fact of the matter is we invite Jesus into our heart and let him do his thing. Philippians 2 verse 13, it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do for, tell me, his good pleasure. God will do the work in your life that you cannot do. You think you are hopeless, you are not. You think you're bad, you are right. Jesus is good, however. You are weak, and God says, my strength is made perfect in weakness. I could never. You are right, but Jesus can, and he will, if only you ask and if only you permit. Friend, isn't it time that we allow Jesus to sit on the throne of our hearts, to remake us? Are we seeking his face? You need to grab hold of the throne of God and, like Jacob, say, I will not let you go until you bless me. I'll not let you go until you give me a new mind and a new heart. I will not let you go until you make me an agreeable human and not a disagreeable human. He's coming back soon. And we may say, I'm in a saving relationship with Jesus. Great. But there are so many of us who don't have that confidence. There were five wise virgins. They had the oil. There were five foolish. They did not. But all 10 were asleep. And it might be that some of us are sleepwalking to the second coming. No, God has better for us than that. If we will seek His face, He will be found of us. There's no question about it. And He'll do in your life what you could never, ever, ever do in your own life. Listen, I want to close by reading a statement from The Desire of Ages because it's just so powerful. And in here is the essence of the Christian experience. Let me read this to you. It's from page 668, and then we close with prayer. It says, all true obedience comes from the heart. It was heart work with Christ. And here it is. And if we consent, remember those four words, and if we consent, He will so identify our thoughts and aims with His, so blend our hearts and minds into conformity to His will, that when obeying Him, we shall be but carrying out our own impulses. Oh, come on. The will, refined and sanctified, will find its highest delight in doing His service. When we know God as it is our privilege to know Him, our life will be a life of continual obedience. Through an appreciation of the character of God, through communion with Him, through seeking His face, sin will become hateful to us. Man, there's the experience of the gospel right there. If we consent, if we allow, permit, if we agree, God will do a work in our life that will prepare us fully and completely for all eternity. Ladies and gentlemen, why don't we major in the majors now and seek His face and receive His Spirit and be transformed so that on that great day when Jesus comes back, gravity will lose its hold on the soles of our feet and we will go up to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Can you say amen tonight? All right, let us pray together. Our Father and our God, we thank You for the Sabbath that has come. We are seeking Your face now. I pray, Lord, that you would step into our lives more fully, that You give us more of Your Holy Spirit, attend to us with a greater amount of angels, somehow cause the world to lose its luster. And those things that we've been pursuing that have been damaging us spiritually, where we've had our priorities out of whack, I'm praying that we make our number one priority Jesus, and that we will want Your grace, and we will want Your will, and we will want Your pleasure more than anything else that we could even imagine. So, Father, tonight we're going to go from here believing that we belong to You and You belong to us. We thank You tonight for Jesus. We look forward to meeting again tomorrow morning. Bless us until then, we pray. Thank You for saving us through Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray, amen and amen. God bless you. Good night. We'll see you tomorrow morning. They've asked me to preach the same sermon twice, so I have to. So they will not be different. God bless you. Good night. Thank you so much.